Welcome to HECTV's live interactive program that's part of St. Louis.
The whole production is pulled together.
This is going to be a steel bridge.
On the American classic novel,
the car that put America on wheels.
Welcome to HECTV Live. Welcome to the Edison Theater on the campus of Washington University in St. Louis for today's program, HECTV Live, A Conversation with Lois Lowry. Hi, everybody. I'm Tim Gore, and I'm very happy to welcome you to the Edison along with these students from the Lift for Life Academy here in St. Louis for the conversation we're going to have today with the Newberry Award winning author Lois Lowry. Our focus is going to be talking about The Giver, which, of course, is a phenomenal young adult novel, and students from across the country are joining us for today's program, not just interactively throughout Missouri, as well as via view-only video conference and web stream from throughout the country. We're looking forward to the conversation. This indeed is the first of five programs that HECTV Live will be doing about The Giver this year, and we thought how appropriate to have the opportunity to start with the author of the book, Lois Lowry. At this time, I want to go to Charlestown, Massachusetts and Bunker Hill Community College. Thanks, Bunker Hill, for making this possible. Bring in Lois Lowry. Good morning, Ms. Lowry. How are you doing?
I'm doing fine, thank you. How are you?
We're absolutely great. We're very excited to have you with us today, and we're really looking forward to today's conversation.
Me too.
We want to start with just a little bit of background information about your life. And at this point, to begin that conversation, I want to turn to a couple of students from Bayless. I want to check to see if our Bayless students have joined us in the bridge. And Bayless, if you're there, we've got a question from Austin and a question from Jenny about Ms. Lowry's background and how she got involved in writing. So take it away, Bayless, if you're with us.
What made you want to become an author?
Oh boy, have to go back a lot of years. I was very lucky to have been born in a household that was filled with books, with parents who read to me. And from the very earliest years, I loved stories. And when I learned how to read and write myself, I realized I wanted to be a writer when I grew up. I was probably no more than, 8 years old when I realized that I wanted to be a writer. And I never changed my mind from then until now.
Thanks for the question, Austin. And Lois, did you start just writing stories at that age? Did you start plunking down stuff on paper?
Plunking down, that's a good word. Yeah, I did. But in those days, and this is way back in the 1940s, because I'm now 73 years old. In those days, schools didn't pay as much attention to writing, so I didn't have assignments to write stories. I did it for myself, and very privately, didn't show what I was doing to anybody. But then as time went on, and I went to high school and then to college, I majored in writing in college when I was 17 years old.
Very cool. We're going to have the opportunity for students to ask more questions of you about your background and your inspirations, but obviously our major focus today is on the novel The Giver, and we want to begin by talking about the setting for the novel. We're going to talk today about setting and character and plot and theme, and Keila, who's right here from Lift for Life Academy, has a question for you about the setting of the novel and how it all got started. So Keila, if you'll just go right on up to the microphone and ask your question loudly and proudly, take it away.
What inspired you to write a novel in this particular genre?
Oh, okay. And now I'm going to give you a question while you're still at the microphone. What genre do you think this book is?
Keila's contemplating. I can see she's contemplating. Keila, give it a shot. What do you think?
Oh, that's mean, isn't it, of me? But are you thinking science fiction, fantasy, futuristic? Because it is all of those things. And so that's what your question is. Why did I decide to write a book set in the future? When I wrote The Giver, I think I had already written probably 14 or 15 other books, and none of them had been set in the future. So what inspired me to do that? I have to think back, because it was a long time ago that I wrote it. I began by thinking about memory. And the reason I was thinking about memory is because my father was very old, and he was losing his memory. And I began to think how important memory is. And what if there were a way we could control memory in people? What if I could magically maybe put my hands on my father's head as he sat there in the nursing home and bring his memory back? What if there were people who could do that, a whole community who could do that. And when I sat down to write the book, I realized that because that wasn't true yet, I would have to set the book in the future. So I just made it an unnamed time. People often ask me, what year is this book taking place? And the answer is, I don't know. It's sometime in the future. But it's a time when technology has developed to the point where they can actually control human memory, the way I could never do for my dad. So I was writing a book for the first time that turned out to be called science fiction or fantasy, two things I had never written before. It was fun to do it, but it was a challenge.
Thank you, Lois, and thank you, Keila, for the question. As we delve into setting a little bit more, Lois, we've got a question that comes to us from Katie at Piermont Elementary. She's more interested in going into the details as you build the community. What's your thought process that you go through as you create the community in terms of how it's going to operate, in terms of what are the things you want the community to be able to do and what you don't want them to be able to do, you know, the lack of color, the lack of sound, those kinds of things?
Okay. When I sat down to write the book, excuse me, I lived in Boston at the time. I lived right in a big city. I no longer lived there, but I was sitting in my office in a big city, looking out the window at city life all around me. And I was sitting down to write a book in which a boy lived in a time in the future. And I began to think what his life would be like, and I looked out the window, and I saw all the things that cause trouble in our lives today. I looked out and I saw a homeless guy on the corner. And I thought about poverty and homelessness. And I thought, okay, I'm gonna get rid of that. This world I'm writing about is not gonna have any poverty. Nobody will be homeless. And then I looked out because I heard cars honking and I saw a little minor traffic accident. And I thought, hey, I think I'll get rid of cars. Cars cause problems. Not going to be traffic problems in my world because people are not going to use cars anymore. And I began to think in those terms. Crime, I didn't look out and see crime, but it was probably happening out there. I got rid of crime. I got rid of divorce. Nobody gets divorced in the world Jonas lives in. Nobody's poor. Nobody's prejudiced. There's no pollution. I looked out the window and I could see pollution all around me. Nobody suffers from any kind of environmental problems. So it became a kind of world that was almost or seemed close to perfect. And I set out, sitting there at my desk, I wrote the kind of rules that would govern such a society where the boy lived. But as I began to write the book and describe the place where he lived, I realized that there was an underside to it that was deeply troubling. And that's what made the book interesting. But in the beginning of the book, I wanted you to feel as though this would be a very cool place to live. Nobody is poor. Nobody is bullied. People are polite to one another. They pay attention to their language. Dinner is delivered to their homes every night. The moms don't even have to cook. And also, everybody's equal. Moms and dads, females and males are equal. They have jobs that are equal. Dad in the book is a child care worker, and mom is a kind of judge. But those jobs in this society are of equal value. And I thought that was an important part. There's no sexism in the book, in the community where he lives. So that's how I started thinking about it. Make it as nice as possible, as comfortable as possible, so that people reading the book will think, hey, I'd like to live there. And then very gradually let them in on the secret of why they wouldn't like to live there.
That's very cool. The very gradual thing is a really cool description as you talk about that. We've got a question that came from the Arts Academy at Summit in Canton, Ohio. They were interested in, like, and partly I think you've answered this, that did you write about the perfect community because you wanted to be able to focus on that kind of like underpinning and that like underworld and that uncertainty of the moral ambiguity of things? Or did that the moral themes and moral tones emerge as a result of the setting and the characters you created?
Well, for starters, I'll explain, and I'm sure you all realize this already, that if you write a book in which everybody is happy and their world is perfect, as is true when this book begins, very soon it's going to be a pretty boring book. And so I knew starting out that although I wanted you to like this place, very soon I wanted you to realize, but gradually, that there are problems. Because problems are what make a book interesting. As a character, a book character moves along from point A, page one, to the end of the book, he has to encounter troubling things. He has to encounter obstacles, things to overcome. And that's true of every book. It's what makes every book interesting. It's what makes you turn the page. And so I knew from the get-go that Jonas was not just going to be portrayed for 200 pages as a boy living in a lovely place, having a nice life. It was going to turn pretty dark pretty soon.
Let's talk a little bit about characters, because obviously these people exist in this setting. And we're going to start with two questions back to back, and then I'd ask you to speak to both of them kind of simultaneously, Lois. We're going to start with DeTavia's question, and then I'm going to go to Jasmine and Jennings. So DeTavia, take it away.
My question is, how did you come up with, how did you come up with the characters' personalities?
So DeTavia wants to know about characters' personalities, and Jasmine's question's a little bit related to that. Jasmine from Jennings, go ahead and ask yours too.
My question is for you, do any of the names of your characters have a significance in your life?
Okay, characters, personalities, and names. They are related questions. When I'm writing a book, of course I have to make up the characters. And the one I pay the most attention to is always going to be, of course, the main character. That's called the protagonist. When I start a book, I have to decide what kind of character that will be, and I always start out thinking boy or girl, male or female. I've written 36, 37 books now. Most of my books have a female main character. You can guess why that is. It's because I'm female, and so it's easier for me to put myself into the mind of a girl. But a number of my books, a smaller number, have a boy as a main character, and The Giver is one of those. So I sat at my desk and I thought, okay, going to create this community. There's got to be a main character, male or female. And I don't remember now why I chose boy. I could have made it a girl. But for some reason, I thought, okay, boy. Then I have to choose what kind of character it is. Every character in a book has to have a personality. They have to be different from one another. And if you think of the characters in The Giver, Jonas, the main character, has a particular personality. But his best friend, Asher, is a very different kind of boy. And his other friend, Fiona, of course, is a girl, and she has a particular personality. As for their names, the names just come to me. And if they seem right, I keep them. Sometimes I change a name in the middle of the book. And I go back, and of course on a computer you find and replace. Sometimes I'll go back and change a character's name. Those all came to me and they stayed. I didn't change any of those names. And they were names that just felt right. But one of them, and that's the character of Asher, was named for this reason. I have a grandson who's now a freshman in college. He's 19. But he was a baby at the time that I was writing that book, and he was named Asher. So I just snitched his name and put it in the book, and he, of course, didn't mind. So then I work at creating their character and revealing their character gradually as the book goes along. A book character has to be well-rounded. He can't be, if you were writing a description of a character that you're making up, and you just wrote popular, smart, fun, well, all of that is great, but it's not a very well-rounded character. And so even a character who's smart and popular and fun has to have some flaws. And you have to think what those might be. Think of people you know and what kinds of characteristics they have. And even a villain, even an evil character in a book. And actually, the book The Giver doesn't have any truly evil characters. But if you were writing a book in which there was somebody who was truly the villain, you would be careful to make sure that he had some small nice characteristics as well, so that he would be a well-rounded character. Creating a character is a lot of fun, but it's work, and you have to sit there with a piece of paper or in your computer on the screen and write down a whole lot of different things that go into making a character seem real.
And Lois, as you do that, as you go into the process of making a character seem real, I'm assuming you keep some stuff and you jettison some things. Is it possible for you to remember that there was a certain character where you wanted them to do something or had a certain vision of them, and then that changed in the course of writing the book?
Oh, I have to think back. I've written so many books since then. I've created so many characters since then. Certainly, I go back and change things. And sometimes I throw things out. I'm remembering now a little place in The Giver where I did make a change. You guys, if you've read the book recently, you may remember that when Asher, Jonas's friend, is called to the stage to receive his assignment, and there, the elder on the stage is describing Asher's childhood, as they do for each kid, and the audience is chuckling, and Asher's kind of a funny character. And it describes when he was little and learning language and misusing language. Here's a section that in the original manuscript was there, but it was later removed. They described how when Asher was 3 or 4, at whatever age they were learning different verbs, it described Asher learning the verb to yearn for something. You guys all know what that means. It's that you want something badly. And it described Asher making a very silly mistake that made the audience laugh. They said when Asher was little, he made this mistake. He was learning about the word to yearn, and he said, "Oh, I am urinating for my snack." Okay, that was silly, and it made the audience in the book laugh, but it was really too silly. And so I went back and took it out. And now I'm trying to remember what was the mistake that Asher did make that got him first punished with the what they call the discipline wand. And that, incidentally, is a place where you begin very early in the book to understand that something's wrong in this society, when you realize that they whip children in order to get them to speak properly and behave properly when they're very, very tiny. So now I've digressed into something different, and we were talking about characters, so I'm going to shut up and hear another question about characters.
Oh, that was a great example, Lois. Thanks for sharing. The kids definitely here chuckled about urinating yearning. So that's a good thing. I want to go to Nayla, who's in Bayless, who's going to ask you a question about you and your relationship to the community. Nayla, go right ahead.
If you lived in the community, which assignment do you think would best suit your qualities and characteristics?
That's a particularly interesting question, because the assignment that would best suit me and that I could have been assigned to when I was 12, and people who knew me would have known me well enough to know this would have been the right assignment, would be to be a writer. However, in the world of The Giver, there is no writer. So that wouldn't have been available to me. There's no writer because there's no imagination, and there are no stories, there are no books, as you know, in that world. So if I were stuck in that world, I would have had a rough time of it. Another assignment that would have been good for me would be to be an artist, but not in that world. There's no art. So what would I have been? I have a horrible feeling that I would have been a birth mother. Sorry. And in fact, I did grow up to be a birth mother. I had 4 children when I was just out of school. Not the kind of birth mother that would have been in Jonas's society, but I don't know what else they could have chosen for me, because I wouldn't have had any of the kinds of interests that the kids in that community did. I wouldn't have been a scientist or a lawyer. Maybe I could have been a child care worker, a nurturer like Jonas's dad.
Thank you, Lois. We've got a specific question about a couple of the characters that comes from Lauren and Terry up in St. Joseph, Michigan. They write that Jonas and the giver are essential to the survival of the community. Theoretically, if they wanted to, they could make any kind of demand of the elders, and those elders would have to agree. If not, Jonas or the giver could release the memories that were so carefully contained at will and cause utter chaos. Do you think it would have been possible for them, Jonas and the giver, to demand the community conform to a new set of rules instead of escaping?
Good question, complicated question. However, it has an easy answer. Yes, of course they could have. And it would have changed the society in which they lived for the better, although there would have been a certain amount of chaos to overcome. But you know why I couldn't do that as a writer? Because that would have been the end, and the book would be maybe 47 pages long. When you're writing a book, you have to have things continue to happen, continue to be challenges for the main characters. And so if Jonas and the giver had taken control as soon as they got together and realized they had that power, boom, the end, and it wouldn't be a very interesting book. So that's why it didn't happen that way.
Well, that's a perfect segue for us to begin to talk a little bit about plot then, because obviously that event not happening is what enables the book to continue. Let's talk in general before we get to some specific questions from students about events in the plot. When you sit down to write a book, how does the plot emerge for you? Are you sitting down with like a chart? Do you have post-it notes you put around? Do you have notes all over? How do you make sure that plot events make sense? How do you go about charting out a plot?
Well, I don't recommend the way that I do it because I'm somewhat disorganized and I rely too much on my own ongoing intuition. Organized authors do have an outline, and I don't. I find that if I write a lengthy outline, then when I sit down to write the story itself, it's boring to me because I've already put all my imagination into writing the outline. So I make it up as I go along. I always have a sense of where it's going. But the plot, as it goes along, surprises me. Things happen that are surprises. And then I have to deal with those surprising elements. And that's what keeps me interested in the work all the way through to the end. I'm working on a book now, which we can talk about in a minute if we have time and want to. But right now I do have three post-it notes on the bottom of my computer screen because I've arrived at a place in the book where I know things are going to happen a few pages or maybe a few chapters farther along, and I don't want to forget that. And so I've just made notes and stuck them to the computer so that I'll know I'm aiming toward that. But I have no idea how this book is going to end. So that's, I need to keep those surprises in front of me as I go along.
So those surprises are actually good for you. I think a lot of people when they begin to write might think that they need to have all of it in their head to be able to put it down on paper. You're saying that for you it's actually a more exciting part of the process to let the book kind of flow as you go.
But let me describe something else. I need to have a sort of destination in mind, because writing a book and reading a book is like going on a journey. So you need to know sort of where you're going to end up so that everything will aim toward that destination. Although you might take, I mean, pretend you're driving on a road from here to here, you might take some side trips to see the scenery. Or you might encounter a place where the road is washed out and you have difficulty getting past it. And that's the same that's true in writing a story. But not long ago, I agreed to do something for a website that had kids in schools all around the country adding parts to a story. I wrote the beginning of the story, and then kids wrote chapters, or maybe just pages, many of them. And so that went on for some weeks. And then I was to write the concluding page of the story, the ending. But the difficult thing was that I wrote the beginning with an ending in mind, and then these kids took over and they added characters that I hadn't thought of, and they had plots going all different directions. And when I got to the point where I had to write the ending, it was very hard to pull all those things together. When I'm working on a story by myself, I have that destination in mind, so I don't veer too far off or introduce too many characters that may become a nuisance in the story as it continues.
Thank you, Lois. Let's go to more student questions, some of them on very specific plot points. We're going to start with Chris's question here from Live for Life. Chris, go right ahead and ask it.
Why does Jonas take the chance of ruining his escape by rescuing Gabriel?
Because Gabriel, the character of Gabriel, though he's just an infant, is very important. It's because of that baby that Jonas realizes his world has to change. Because of what is in store for Gabriel, because he knows Gabriel will be killed, because he has learned to love that baby, that he takes every action he does from then on. If Gabriel were in the story up to that point and then is put to death, as is scheduled for him, and then Jonas says, oh, I hate it here, and leaves alone, the story is different and it's not as important. It was Jonas's learning to love somebody else that propels the entire last section of the book.
Thanks for the question, Chris. Thank you, Lois. We've got a question that comes again from Piermont Elementary. About Miranda wants to know, how did you come up with the idea to suggest that Rosemary was the giver's daughter?
Yeah, again, it's hard for me to remember details in the writing of the book so many years ago. But I do remember that in the first version, in the first draft of the novel, Rosemary didn't exist. And of course, a book goes through several drafts. I'll write a manuscript of a book, as I'm doing right now at home, and then it will be finished. I'll print it out, and then I'll have a stack of pages, and then I reread it. I like reading it on printed pages rather than on the computer. And then I will go back and revise it. So then I have the first draft, and then I'll come up with a second draft. And most often, at the end of the second draft, I think it's finished. I think it's as good as I can make it. And then I give it to the publisher, and then, surprise, they don't think it's as good as I can make it, and they will send me a long letter with suggestions. They don't rewrite it, but they'll say things like, this section is a little unclear. Can you make this clear? What's the motivation of this character? And so then I go back to it. And so when I gave them what was a second draft of what I had written, they came back with a long letter. And I can tell you a funny thing that they alerted me to in that letter. But at that point, I'll go back and do revisions. And it was at that point that Rosemary entered. And I cannot now remember why it was that we needed Rosemary. Perhaps it was to give a little more sense of humanity and compassion to the man who was the giver. But let me tell you a funny thing that I had to add in, or actually take out, after I heard back from the editor. In the book that I gave them, what I thought was a finished book, the children's bicycles, once Jonas could see color, he realized that the children's bicycles were different colors at different ages. And so there were red bicycles and blue bicycles and green bicycles. And the editor wrote in the letter, why would they be manufacturing bicycles in different colors if they don't see color? Why would they even have paint? And of course, they were right. So I had to go back and take that out. I took out every mention of color in a manufactured object. Originally, the thing in which Jonas first saw red was a ball. In the book, it's an apple. But again, when I reread it, I thought, why would they be making a ball in red or blue or any other color? And so it's an apple in which he sees red. The other things he begins to see color in are flowers and grass and pumpkins. But nothing is manufactured because, of course, they wouldn't be manufacturing things in color. But I had to have that pointed out to me by the publisher.
We've had a lot of questions that deal with the ending of the book, and we're going to go to a couple of them back to back to start with from students who are interactive with us. Reeves, let's go to you and Wydown for your question, and then we'll go to Celestina Jennings for her, and we'll let Ms. Lowry talk about the ending based on both those questions. Take it away, Reeves.
Hi, my name is Reeves Oyster, and my question is, I know that you've had never said what exactly happens in the end of The Giver, but what can you tell us about the ending? Like, what was going through your head?
Celestine, go right ahead.
Okay.
Hello, my name is Celestine, and my question for you, Miss Lowry, is why did you end the book the way you did?
So we've got that question coming from a lot of people. Go for it, Lois.
Yeah, many questions about that. When I first wrote the book, I liked leaving the ending what's called ambiguous, which means that it could be any one of a number of things, and the reader would have to decide for his or herself. I kind of liked that. And in fact, I was interviewed a number of times, and then I made a speech accepting the Newberry Medal, and all of those I said I wasn't going to write a sequel, wasn't going to explain the ending. However, years passed, and I get a lot of mail. I get both regular mail, and nowadays I get email. Anybody can email me through my website. And I began to get so much mail, literally thousands of messages and letters, from kids who wanted the ending to be more precise, more explained. And I had begun to think myself about things connected to the world of the giver. So I sat down several years later, and you guys might not be aware of this, but I wrote a second and eventually a third book that are not sequels, but I call them companion books to the giver. The second book is called Gathering Blue. And it's about a different community, different kind of people. The main character is a girl who lives there. And at the very end of that book, there is mention of a boy, a blue-eyed boy. And that boy is Jonas. And kids who read that book and have read The Giver recognize him. Then there's a third book called Messenger. And the third book is set in a third place, but now it's 7 years later. And Jonas and Gabriel both are living in this third place. And this is the place they found when they left the community in The Giver. And it's very different. And Jonas is now the leader of this third community. In fact, in this place, people have, instead of using their names, are given titles. And the young man in the book is called Leader. But you will know very quickly when you're reading it, who that is. Gabriel, who hasn't gotten old enough yet, he's only 8, to have a title, is still called Gabriel, and there's a slight mention of him as an 8-year-old. And that's the book called Messenger. What I'm working on now is a fourth book, because I'm still, just like readers, I've become so fascinated by these characters and what's happening to them, that I began to explore that in a fourth book, which I'm beginning to think is going to be very long. It's taking me forever to write it. So it'll be a couple of years before that one's published, and I don't know its title yet.
Thanks very much, Lois. That gives us a lot of excellent information, because we had questions from Loringer, Louisiana, from St. Francis de Sales in Newark, Ohio, Arts Academy at Summit and Canton, and other people that were really interested in what happened at the end and if Jonas had made it to the other village and if there were sequels. So if they're not familiar with those other stories, this gives them an opportunity to go to that. I want to let you and everybody else in our audience see the wide variety of people that are joining us. We've got a map that shows you the different locations where all our audience members are joining us today, and we've received questions from all over the country and indeed all over the world here. You'll notice we're in Canada, as well as various states throughout the United States. And I don't know if you can tell, but down in the lower right-hand corner, there's a red dot because St. Croix, the Virgin Islands, is also with us, as well as Ontario, Canada, and those states you see there. Those are the folks we know are here as part of this conversation today, Lois. And we might indeed have other folks joining us as well. I'll remind everybody to mute your microphones.
Up at the top of the United States, to the right of Idaho, my geography is so bad. Is that Wyoming or Montana?
That's Montana.
Okay, that's I'm just going to tell the people in Montana that I'm going to be in Bozeman in early November speaking at a literary festival put on by the library in Bozeman. See you then.
Well, cool. We've got a couple of schools joining us from Montana, so hopefully they'll be able to make it. That's great. Let's begin to explore themes a little bit. And again, I'll remind everybody at the other locations to keep your microphones muted as we have this conversation. There's a lot of themes that people might think are emerging in the book and as we talk about characters and plot, but there's a question specifically about the theme as you might have looked at it. Marcia, I hope I'm pronouncing your name right, or is it Martia? Martia or Marcia, go right ahead.
My name is Martia, and my question for you is this book an example of your views of how the world should be today?
Okay, should I answer that question or are there others that go with it?
No, go right ahead with that one, Lois. Thank you.
Okay. No, I think all of you, if you've read the book, begin at the beginning of the book to feel as though that might be a cool place to live. It would be nice if the world were that way. There's, as I described earlier, there's no crime, there's no war, there's no sickness that we know of, there's no poverty. But then if you complete the reading of the book, you realize there are other things missing that are so important to us. And that is why it's not the kind of world I would like to live in. It's a world that has given up, has sacrificed human emotions. So people don't love one another. They're very polite, but they don't really care about each other. They also have lost literature. They have no books. They have no art. They have no music. Can you imagine a world with no music? Do you want to live in that kind of world? No, I don't think so. So, no, the answer to your question is, no, I certainly do not want to live in that kind of world. I wasn't writing about the kind of world that I would enjoy living in. But there are things about their world that I think we could hope to, that we could aspire to. It would be nice if we lived in a world with no war and no crime and no poverty. But we don't want to sacrifice the important things that those people in the book have given up for their world.
Thanks, Lois, and thank you, Martia, for that question very much. Vanessa and Amanda, again coming from St. Joseph, Michigan, write that the giver mentions the fact that Fiona and Jonas's dad does not understand the gravity of releasing a human being because he has no feelings. Jonas has feelings because he has obviously experienced the giver's memories, but if he had not, he would be just as blind as the rest of the inhabitants. Do you suggest then that memories are what invoke feelings in us, that memories are essential to developing feelings for people?
Well, that's an interesting question, and I'm not sure I can answer it. But certainly the things, I mean, you guys that I'm talking to, you students are what, 12, 13, 14, 15 years old. You don't have the long lifetime of memories that I do, but you certainly have plenty of memories and you've experienced a lot of stuff and you've felt a lot of emotions. I've lived to be in my 70s and I've, for example, here's a sad but good example. One of my children has died. One of my children was killed in an accident. That's part of my memories. It's part of what makes me human, having experienced that kind of sadness. And you've all experienced sadness. The people in The Giver have not. People in The Giver have never been sad. And so that is part of what makes us human, I think, the memories, the things we experience and think about and live with and talk about to each other. Those are things that make us very human.
To keep up with that, we had a question from Arts Academy at Summit in Canton, Ohio. What do you believe, they ask, is the most important message in the book? Is one thing more important than another to you?
You know, I don't like books with messages because it gives me the picture of a teacher giving a test and saying, what is the message of this book? And of course, it's different for different people. Whatever you get out of a book depends in part on what you bring to the book. But for me, one of the important things in the book, The Giver, is to understand the importance of choices that we make as human beings. And you can even bring that down to political choices. You know, we all, once we're adults, we vote and we choose who we want our leaders to be. The people who live in the world of The Giver, they've sacrificed a lot of stuff. And so I think that's an important thing to remember. They've sacrificed freedom, really. They have a lot of good stuff in their world, but they have really no freedom. And so I think the message that I would take from the book is that we must be very, very careful about the choices we make and the sacrifices we make.
Thanks very much, Lois. One final question about theme comes again from Jennings. Rachel, let's go to you and Jennings.
Good morning, Ms. Lowry. My question is The Giver anywhere related to religion?
That's an interesting question, The Giver and religion. When I was writing the book, that never occurred to me. And yet, after the book was published, I began almost immediately to hear from people who found religious significance in the giver. And I think for Christians, one of the things they found was the concept of the boy making a sacrifice, Jesus-like. But at the same time, I hear from a lot of Jewish people who give the book as a bar mitzvah gift, because for them it involves a boy entering manhood and taking on the responsibilities of adulthood. I hear from people from many different religions who find significance in the book, The Giver. I think the one thing that's true of all of them, and no, I'm not going to say yes, it's a Christian book, or yes, it's a Jewish book, or yes, it's Islamic in its nature. I think the one thing that unites all religions is the fact that all religions teach people to care about one another. And that's the important thing in the book, The Giver. The fact that the people in that book have lost the capacity to care about one another and need to get it back. And you'll see if you read the two books that continue the world of the giver, you'll see that that's still an important element. So in that sense, I guess you could say it's religious, but I didn't have any particular religious doctrine in mind when I wrote the book.
Thanks very much for that question from Jennings. And Lois, thanks for your answer. We're going to go to some more general questions now and also begin to talk, Lois, about writing style again and other things you've got upcoming. I want to turn to Dirk here from Lift for Life, who's got a question for you about the book and what might have influenced you to write certain ways. Dirk, feel free to change the microphone for yourself. You got it, young man. Go for it.
Have you or anyone you have ever known ever had to make a life-changing decision like Jonas?
No. I think I and people I know have never experienced a moment that like the one that Jonas does, where he has to make a decision that is going to change his life and the whole world. But we all throughout our lives do face important decisions that are going to direct our life from then on. Just none of the magnitude of that in the book. It's an interesting question, though. I have to think about it some more, so we'll have to go on to other questions.
Cool. Okay. Thanks, Dirk. Armin, I want to go to you guys in Bayless, because you want to talk about the genesis of the book, how long it took. Armin, what's your question?
How long did it take you to come up with the story, and did it publish on the first try?
Coming up with the idea for the story, that just arose spontaneously. As a result of visiting my father at a time when he was losing his memory. Then I sat down to write it. Many books take me about 6 months to write. This one took longer because it was a more complicated book and because it had to be rewritten a couple of times. So it probably took me a year to write it. And then you asked whether it was published on my first try. What happens is that anybody out there can write a book. And many people do. You have to sit down and spend a lot of time doing it, but you end up with a manuscript, and you can send that to a publisher. It doesn't matter if you're in eighth grade or if you're 103. You can send your manuscript to a publisher, and they will look at it and decide whether they want to publish it. The problem for most people is that publishers receive, I don't know, 20,000 manuscripts a year, or 50,000, and of course they can't publish all of those, and so most people will get their manuscript back with a polite note saying, sorry, we've decided against this. But when I wrote The Giver, it was probably 16th of my books, so the same publisher had already published 15 books by me, and the same editor had been my editor for all those books. So when I gave them this book, they knew they were going to publish it. And I didn't have to go through that process of mailing it off to strangers and waiting for months to get a reply. So yeah, it was published on the first try.
Congratulations for that, obviously. And Noah has a question that kind of relates to that, because he's interested, he talks about writing his own ideas. Noah from Watertown, go ahead and ask your question.
I sometimes find it really, really hard to write down some of my ideas for writing, but you've written so many books and I've read a lot of them, so I really wanted to know what motivates you to, like, write all these great ideas down, because it takes a lot of time.
It does take a lot of time, and you know what the motivation is? It's how I make my living. If I don't write books, I don't get paid. So it's like anybody who has a job. You go to work every day because that's how you make your living. Luckily, when you're your age, you don't have to make a living yet. But that means also that it's harder for you to sit down and work hard at something because you got so many other things to do. But I sit there every day in my office and work. I'm one of the luckiest people around because my job, the way I make my living, is doing what I love. Some people have to go to work every day doing something they hate, and I feel sorry for those people. I think I'm very lucky. So good luck to you. I hope you get. I hope you continue writing and writing your ideas down, and maybe eventually you'll be a published author.
Thanks very much for the question, Noah. Lois, as we talk more about what you do to write, we've got a number of questions that have come from students about process for you. For example, June in Throop Elementary wants to know where you write your books. Like, do you have a favorite place in the house that you sit and write? And a couple of students from St. Joseph, Michigan are interested in knowing, do you have certain people who look at each book besides your publisher, your editor? Do you give the book to other people to read for feedback?
Okay, I'll answer the second part first. No, I write it by myself. I read it to myself. I read it aloud, incidentally, because often you can, rather than looking at the page, you can hear how the words flow if you read them aloud. So when I'm finished, I do read it aloud and make some changes. But nobody else sees it until I get to the publisher, until I give it to the publisher. So I don't pass it around to my friends. I don't even let my dog look at it. But where I write it is this. I have two houses. I think I'm lucky that way. I live in a town, in a city, not in a downtown, but in a residential neighborhood. And I live in a house that used to belong to a doctor who had his office in the house. So when I moved into that house, I took his office, and it's separate from the living space. So I have a separate office, which is very private. Then I also have a house in the country, which is very isolated, in a very rural area. And I go there in the summer. And sometimes I go up there in the winter as well. That's in Maine. And there I have a room also where I work. So in both places I have a space that is very private, very quiet, and just for me. And I think that's important. When I was beginning to write many, many years ago, I didn't have a room of my own where I worked when my kids were growing up, but I had a corner of a room where I had my desk. And the kids knew that was Mom's, and you don't go and sit at her desk and use her stuff. This is before computers, so in those days it was a typewriter. And my kids knew that they couldn't go there and that was private and that was mine. I think it's very important if you're a serious writer, and even if you're a kid, it's important to have a space where you do that work and that you don't share it with other people, and that it's private and personal and yours and important. That makes it important.
As we continue to talk about your interest in writing, we've got some more questions in terms from Arts Academy at Summit. Why do you write for an adolescent audience as opposed to an adult audience? And have you also written for adult novels? And is the process different?
That's an interesting question. I began by writing for adults. I wrote for magazines for adults. And then came a time when I had published a short story in a magazine, an adult magazine. And it was about a child. It was about myself as a child, but I'd written it as fiction. And when it was published, a children's book publisher wrote to me and asked if I would write a book for young people. So I did my first book for them, and that was called A Summer to Die. And I continued writing for adults, but then I did a second book for young people. And by the time I did the third book for young people, I was beginning to get a lot of letters from kids. This is before computers, before email. And I began to get a feeling for how important a book can be in the life of a young person. You guys, at your age, are still at a time in your life when you're deciding who you're going to be. You're still making choices. If I write a book for somebody 65 years old, they may enjoy the book, but it's not going to affect their life. It's not going to determine who they are. But if you, at age 14, read a book that means a lot to you, it may be an important factor in determining who you're going to be. And I began to realize, when I realized that writing books for kids is actually more important than writing things for adults. And so gradually, I began to focus more and more on that. And now it's very rare that I write for adults. Almost everything I do is for a young audience.
Thank you, Lois. Thank you very much. Some folks in St. Francis de Sales in Newark, Ohio, and Lily from Throop Elementary in Paoli, Indiana, want to know if you have certain favorite books to read or certain favorite authors of your own.
Well, it surprises people sometimes to know that I don't read other young adult books. I have a lot of friends who are authors of young adult books, names of people you know, I'm sure. But I don't read their books because I think people like to read, how can I describe this? People like to read a book in which the main character is somebody they can identify with. And so for me, it's more difficult to identify with a 14-year-old. I'd rather read a book about somebody my age. I'd rather read a book about a middle-aged woman than a 10-year-old boy. So I read books that are published for adults, even though I don't write them. That's kind of odd, I think. And so I have a lot of favorite authors, but they're people you've never heard of.
We're obviously here at Edison because this is where Metro Theater Company is going to produce in January their stage version of The Giver that's written by Eric Koble. My question for you is, Lois, did you have any relationship with the author of the play as he began to adapt the novel? Have you had we had a question from students about, have you had other books adapted into plays or movies? Or if people talked about adapting, for example, The Giver into a movie, what's the process of working with an adapter?
Okay. The author of the book has to give permission for somebody to adapt the book. And so I gave permission to Eric Koble, but I've never met him still, although his play has been around for a very long time. I got an email just yesterday from a woman, now I'm forgetting where she was, at a university somewhere, wanting to do an adaptation of The Giver for the stage using dance. It was a very interesting project, but I had to tell her no, because I gave permission to Eric Koble, and it's exclusive permission. He's the only one who's allowed to write a play of The Giver. I had never written a play at the time that he asked that permission. Sometimes when I think about it, I like what he did, but I sometimes wish, oh, why didn't I write that play? But I didn't. However, since then, I have adapted one of my books, a book called Gossamer. I have adapted to the stage, and that play has been performed in, let me think, Chicago, Philadelphia, Milwaukee, Portland, Oregon. So I would like to do that again sometime, but it's too late for me to do it for The Giver. The Giver is going to become an opera soon. Somebody is writing the music for it now, that will be different, of course, from the play. So that was a different permission. And also, there is a musical version that's not yet published of The Giver. So all of those things are different. And then moving over to Hollywood, hooray for Hollywood, that's a whole other thing. The Giver has been in Hollywood for 14 years. They've been trying to make a movie of it. And various people have worked on it, including for a brief period of time, maybe 2 years, Jeff Bridges was my new best friend. He used to call me occasionally, sent me Christmas cards, sent me a Christmas present once. But now he's no longer part of it, and other people are working on The Giver. Whether it will ever be actually a movie, I don't know. And do I care? It would be great to see it made into a great movie. But two of my books a long time ago were made into very bad movies, and that's very disappointing too. One of them changed the title of my book, and I was very glad they did, because I didn't want anybody to know that terrible movie was made from my book. So all of that is a complicated process, and it takes a lot of time, and I'm glad that Eric Koble did a good job with it, and I hope some of you guys get to see the play when it's produced.
Thanks, Lois. These kids from Lift for Life will definitely be here, as well as hundreds of others, maybe thousands of other kids from the St. Louis metro area who will see the production here. As we have like 90 seconds left, Lois, what closing comments would you like to leave with the students about the joy and power of writing, reading, being an author? Any ideas that crossed your mind that would be cool for the kids to know to close the show?
Well, yeah. One thing about being a writer, and I know many, many people would like to be a writer, and many, maybe some of you would. I know Noah, I think it was, who said he would. It's a very solitary thing. You have to do it all by yourself, sitting alone in a room. I happen to love that. But at the same time, it's a real treat for me to do something like this, where I'm getting to interact with the people who read my books. And that doesn't happen as often as I wish it could, because I have to be sitting there alone in the room, just me, my dog lying at my feet, and my computer. And, of course, the book characters, they begin to seem very real to me, and for the period of time that I live with them, they really are my family.
Joshua, take it away.
What is the process of getting a book published?
Like, what do you have to go through? What are the steps if you want to start from scratch, so to speak, and you've never done it before?
I was recommending a couple of books. One is called Writer's Markets, and the other is called Literary Marketplace. And both of them are about how to get a manuscript published. And so once you follow the instructions for how to prepare a manuscript, which you can get from one of those books, of course, I'm guessing that you've already written your manuscript, and that's the hardest part. Then you can send it to a publisher. The important thing is to send it to the kind of publisher who might be interested in that kind of book, because it takes them a long time to get around to reading your manuscript and making a decision about it. If you send your science fiction spaceship manuscript to a publisher that specializes only in books about animals, then you're going to waste a lot of time. It's going to sit there on their desk for some months, and finally they'll return it to you. Once you send your manuscript off, then you just have to stay home and wait. I mean, you don't have to stay home. You have to wait for it to be returned or to hear from the publisher. If you're really, really lucky, you'll get a letter saying, "We love your manuscript. We'd like to publish it. Here's some money." And if you're the more usual writer, you're going to get a letter saying, "Here's your manuscript back. We're sorry. We don't have room to publish it." And then you send it off to the next publisher on your list, and there are many publishers out there. So it's a time-consuming process. It's a hard way to make a living. So if you want to be rich and famous, you're going to have to wait a long time. You have to wait until the book is published, which takes a couple of years, say. And then you have to wait until it has sold. And then what you get, money-wise, is 10% of the price of the book. So if a book costs $10, you're going to get a dollar each time that book is sold, but you're not going to get it for another 6 months. And so it is not a way to get rich quick. I don't know any way to get rich quick, but if you want to be a writer, that shouldn't matter. What should matter to you is the wonderful enjoyment of sitting at a computer and putting words on a page and listening to how they sound and to how a story moves along and how you can make it better.
We've got a couple of the young people here who are going to be part of the performance of the Metro Theater Company's production of The Giver. And I wanted them maybe to hear you talk a little bit about character. If I'm portraying Jonas, if I'm portraying Fiona, if I'm portraying, or do we have another person here who's portraying someone else? Lily, if I'm portraying Jonas or Fiona or Lily, are there any things from the author's perspective that you'd like them to think about?
Oh, gosh, that's interesting. I've seen the play often before, and of course, every time it's with different performers. And you know, I've seen it in different cities, and each one brings their own self to it. And it's always, and they add a great deal, more than is in the script or the book. So my guess is that those of you there who are going to be in the play will already bring your own personality to it. Asher is always an interesting. You didn't mention Asher being there in the audience. You mentioned Lily, I think, and Jonas and Fiona. But Asher is always a fun character, and he's the one I've actually enjoyed seeing most on the stage. But each of the characters are unique, and each of the actors are unique. So I don't know that I can add to that. I think you have to bring your own self to it.
Cool. Thanks, Lois. I want to go to Jennings before we break up the conversation here. Jennings, do you have a question that you didn't get to during the program that you'd like to ask?
No, we're doing great. I am so thankful for this. This has been so informative.
Thanks so much, Leslie. It's great to have you here. And Lift for Life, I know you guys have to leave for lunch in like 5 minutes. Does anyone have a burning question you need to raise your hand and you want to ask at a moment in time? Yes, young man, come right to the microphone so she'll be able to hear you. What's your name, sir?
Lewis.
Lewis, go right to the microphone.
I got a question in the beginning of the book with the fighter aircraft. Why do they need it? I mean, to go look for people, but why particularly a fighter aircraft? And with the speaker system, why couldn't they have a law enforcement, like officers, instead of like just the judges and whatnot?
It's an interesting question. I've often thought in recent years, since the publication of the book, that I didn't really need the aircraft. You always look for a way to begin a book that will be exciting, that will draw the reader in, and so I wanted something happening right at the beginning. But I think you're correct. Why do they need a fighter plane when they obviously don't indulge in warfare anymore? So I think, frankly, I think that's a flaw in the book, that if I had a chance to go back and rewrite the book, I would probably take that out and find a different way to enter the world of the giver with something else that's exciting without being that aircraft. As for police, is that what you were describing? They don't seem to really need law enforcement. They clearly have people who commit infractions of the rules and are brought up before the judge, but there's no violence and there's no real crime, so I don't think they really need a law enforcement agency.
Lois, thanks for the question. Lois, that leads me to maybe a final question that we could tie everything up with that kids frequently ask. And that is, how do you know when you're done with the book? You talk about the fact that you might revisit it now. I mean, when you send a book off, whether, let's talk about the book you're writing, you're working on right now, as opposed to The Giver. How do you figure out that I'm here, I'm there, and this is it? I'm ready to birth the baby, so to speak.
Yeah, it's hard. And of course, people complained that I had ended The Giver too hastily. It wasn't hasty on my part, but it feels hasty to some readers. For me, when I get to the end of a book, I can always feel it, I think, where all of the different strings that are out there are now tied up and completed, but that some things are going to be ongoing. I mean, obviously, the lives that are portrayed in a book are going to continue after the book ends. But the book ends, I think, it should end where the reader feels as though everything has been completed, but that the reader knows how things will progress after the book. And that's what people complained about with The Giver. They didn't know, and I wanted them to use their imagination more, but I've discovered people don't like using their imaginations in that way. So I need to end a book with the feeling that things have come to a kind of completion, but that the characters are going to live on and that the reader feels comfortable knowing how they're going to live on. And I think you'll find that that's true in the books that follow The Giver, Gathering Blue and Messenger, and the one with no title that I'm working on now.
Lois, thank you very much for joining us. It's been a real pleasure to connect with you, and I want to thank Chuck and everybody at Bunker Hill Community College for making that happen as well. And I'm hopeful that while the dog sits there and sits with you while you write your book, that he doesn't end up eating your book copies in the same way that he might be eating some student homework at some point in time. I want to thank everybody who's been part of today's program. Our next show with HECTV Live will celebrate October's Disability Awareness Month as we learn more about the Disability Project here in St. Louis, and we'll be back for four more shows with the folks at Metro Theater Company throughout the fall. Thanks, everybody. It's always great to be part of HECTV Live with you.